Hello and welcome to tonight's book reading session of Preparing for the Day After. Preparing for the Day After, a picture e-book, is a photojournalistic treatise on disaster mitigation published by me, Malini Shankar, and Walter Keller for the 10th anniversary of the Asian tsunami. Tonight's book reading on chapter 10 will include survivors and heroes of the Asian tsunami who overcame and reached out to other survivors. I will read out, you will meet people from some exotic locales. But let us first recap what we have learned in the previous book reading session before starting tonight's session. Water and sanitation is central to developmental discourse. Culture-sensitive food security also has evolved out of agrometeorological conditions prevalent in an area. Livelihoods based on local agrometeorological conditions are the best means of ensuring livelihood security. Climate change adaptation, menstrual hygiene, especially for indigenous tribal women, solid waste management, universal healthcare access, sustainable development goals, they are all factors to be included in the developmental agenda. Media personnel have to be trained in reporting disaster preparedness or the lack of it at the district level. Disaster is the impact of a calamity on the human landscape. This includes the impact on lives, livelihoods, livestock, and landscape. Tonight's video will profile 3 to 5 heroes. Shankar, a fisherman in Katchal Island of Middle Nicobar Group of Islands in India's Nicobar District in Andaman Nicobar Islands, wrote his bravado in saving his family's treasure, a wooden dinghy, instead of attending to the destruction the tsunami wrought on his seaside home. Being perplexed by the intensity of froth in the first initial wave that followed the mega earthquake, his first thoughts were to save the dinghy, which would not have stood a chance of survival in the face of powerful waves. The artisanal fisherman, after all, depended on the skimpy boat to earn his livelihood for subsistence fisheries. So when he saw dense, frothy waves, far out at sea, heading towards his seaside home in Katchal, he became nervous and wanted to save his worldly possession that guaranteed his bread and butter, subsistence fishing. He had never felt such a humongously big earthquake before and never had in his wildest imagination thought the earthquake would shake the ocean and push the earth out of existence. He never for an instance related the mega earthquake to the ocean's queer behavior that day. The previous day he had just come back with his brother after fishing and had anchored his boat to the jetty. He had decided to do something to save his boat. That was his only livelihood. After the mega earthquake, he ran towards the jetty where other fisher folk had gathered half in panic. Without thinking any further, he ran out with his elder brother towards the jetty to untie the anchor and jettison it on the pyre, because he thought the mighty waves that seemed to be coming would surely pulverize the wooden dinghy. Many other fisher folk's boats were anchored at the fishing harbour. Shankar and his brother reached the boat and untied the anchor. By then the saishes had started swelling the backwaters and it became impossible for them to hold on to the boat. The first frothy wave seemed to have hit shore, dismantling at one go all the boats that were anchored. At that moment, Shankar could only think of surviving himself. He was swept out on the islands of the sea strait that is surrounded by the islands of Komorta, Daring, Katchal and Nankauri. He was swept out and dumped on the beaches at least a few times. I do not remember, madam, how many times I was washed ashore, says Shankar. Finally, after a few hours, he was deposited on the swollen, battered, debris-strewn shoreline, which was still swollen with seawater. The jetty was in pieces and boats were ripped apart. Sand had invaded the jungle on the hillside where the fishing village dotted the wilderness. He was so tired that he could not get up. Marveling at his luck for being saved from the wrath of an angry sea, he limped to get up and struggled to walk. Miraculously, his brother also came ashore moments later and they hugged each other in fraternal affection, almost certainly grateful to be alive. They looked around in awe at what had happened. Dead bodies were floating around in the swollen backwaters and flotsam included boats, oars, craft and gear, household items like kitchen utensils, scooters, cars, lanterns, television sets, refrigerators, etc. were all floating in the debris. The home seemed to be disbanded with its skeletal framework of woodwork jutting out like spikes in the horizon, almost blending with the skeletal frame of trees barely breathing after the calamity. He heard screams coming from the top side of the hillside. He looked up and scanned the hillside, his eyes instinctively searching for his sloping red tiled roofed home. Blending with the forest thicket around what was once the location of his home, there wasn't much left of the home, he could tell that, certainly. It looked so macabre that it reminded him of a childhood vision of hell. That can be scary for any adult. Guilt invaded his whole soul at that moment as he realized with pain stabbing his heart that if there is nothing left in his home, there is not much of a chance of his parents, niece, nephew, sister-in-law surviving these behemoth waves. His heart sank at the very thought that his family might not have survived. His brother's glance was an admission of worry on the same lines, and they found their feet climbing the hillside towards their home almost benumbed. They walked apace, silently, concern killing their hearts. As they arrived at what was once their tile-roofed wooden home, their hearts sank further as there was nothing left of their happy home. Alas, destiny heard their agony, and the brothers heard their sister-in-law call out to them from higher on the hillside. Shankar ran up as best as he could, given how drained he was physically and emotionally. 22-year-old Shankar met his parents safe there and felt so relieved. Then he regaled his folks about what had happened and then exchanged notes about the waves that had hit the hillsides. Then finally he could sink in the import of the day's calamitous events after glancing around. The first view without anxiety for his dear life tugging his heart. By then, glancing around at the hell his idyllic fishing village had transformed itself to, Shankar was consumed by more guilt. The sensitive lad of 22 felt pangs of guilt that scores of villagers had perished, bodies were floating. Shankar confabulated with his brother about what best they can do, but his brother told him that darkness had descended and they should not do anything more for today since they were exhausted anyway. Early next morning, Shankar and his brother went by their boat to the hill adjacent to Daring in the opposite island. They anchored their boat firmly to a fallen tree and they started climbing the hill, rummaging through the debris of fallen trees and the damaged village of Daring. With great difficulty, they reached the hilltop, all the while calling out to the survivors with chants of "Koi hai?" or "Is anyone there?" There seemed to be a faint hope of survivors. Yet Shankar and his brother wanted to survey the whole hill. They after all knew what a struggle for life in the tsunami meant. As they reached the hilltop around noon, they started facing a series of what seemed like flashes on their faces. Looking down into the seaside at the bottom of the hill, and the brothers saw about 500 odd people desperately seeking their attention by flashing debris they had collected, which could be used to reflect sunlight. Shankar and his brother strangely felt rewarded at the sight of humans in need of their help. They walked down with motivation, lending strength to their stride. A sense of pragmatism overcame them as they approached the survivors who were elbowing themselves for survival above swollen waters. Shankar and his brother called out to them saying a calamity had struck the islands after a big earthquake and that scores of people were dead. But they, the survivors, have now been located, so Shankar and his brother would hurry back to bring back rescue teams and boats to take them back to safety on dry land. Desperate calls not to abandon them rent the air, but Shankar and his brother convinced them that they had only one small wooden craft, which could not possibly accommodate all of them, so they have to bring back rescue teams anointed by the administration. With concern gnawing at their own hearts, Shankar and his brother managed to convince the survivors and hurried towards their boat on the other side of the hill. There was so much to be done in a race against time, and heaven knows they did not want to fail any desperate survivor who had already spent one saucy winter night after a near-death experience in the sea. The brothers rowed back to Kamortha and approached the Coast Guard station, which was involved in search and rescue, relief, recovery, all at once, it seemed. He next went to the office of the assistant commissioner and explained to the overwhelmed administrators that they wanted some help in terms of rescue equipment, boats to bring back survivors whom they had located. Shankar and his brother made it a point to reassure the officials that they were not trying to make a quick buck, that all they wanted was to rescue the survivors. Therein lies his heroism. They were then given two fishing trawlers, and with their own boat they went to the location where the survivors were all helped ashore to dry land. They were given food, water and clothing, and in two or three round trips all of them were rescued and brought back to Kamortha, the headquarters of the Middle Nicobar district that comprises of Chowra, Bampoka, Batimalv, Teresa, Trinket, Isle of Man, Nankauri, Katchal, Kamortha, Thilanchong and Dering. The lesson to be learned from this experience is that search and rescue gear, trained crews and emergency services should be ever vigilant, and equipment cannot be compromised upon in archipelagos or other geographically challenged areas. Now next we go to Tilly Smith. A 10-year-old lass from Surrey in England was holidaying with her parents at the Maikau beach in Phuket, Thailand. She has earned the epithet Angel of the Beach. Her first person account of the day's experience was published on the UNISDR's Twitter and RSS feed. I have included the link in the description box below. On seeing the receding waters of the sea and bubbles appearing on the sea surface, Ms. Tilly Smith immediately recognized the early warning signals of a potential tsunami. Barely 2 weeks before her Christmas holiday, she had learned of the phenomenon of a tsunami in a geography class. The attentive young girl applied her knowledge to effective use the day calamity struck so hard on humanity. She immediately told her parents, who in turn alerted the resort staff. The resort staff immediately evacuated the beach, accounting for no loss of life reported at the Maikau beach in Phuket, possibly the only place in Phuket which was spared the killing power of the tsunami. Another true life hero was Dr. J. Radhakrishnan, IAS officer of the Tamil Nadu cadre in Tamil Nadu government. Given the meticulous records kept by the government of Tamil Nadu in general and Dr. Radhakrishna IAS in particular, I would be doing injustice to the reader if I do not put it down in his own words. He was the collector of Thiruvararu, a hinterland district behind the coastal district of Nagapattinam, on the day of the Asian tsunami. Nagai, as Nagapattinam is fondly referred to in short, district authorities called DC Radhakrishna in panic. 9:17 a.m. The first waves of the killer tsunami strikes the coast of Nagapattinam town on a bright Sunday morning. Immediately after this, the then sub-collector of Nagapattinam division, Dr. P. Umanath IAS, the ASP Thiru Damor and the superintendent of police Thiru Abdul Rahuf rushed to the seashore. Meanwhile, the subsequent waves came roaring and water came up to their hip level as they regrouped themselves and reorganized rescue and relief. 9:30 a.m. The then district collector of Nagapattinam, Thiru Veera Shanmuga Moni, IAS officer, who was on official permission and returning from Palani, was contacted. He was informed that many people had probably perished, but the situation was unclear and he started rushing back immediately. Even though the district is used to challenges of natural calamities, including the floods in October and November of 2004, the tsunami initially caught the people totally unawares on account of the fact that it was unknown and came in stealthily and ferociously. The fact that it also affected area staff compounded the problem. That the existing staff swung into action along with the local people was a reflection of the character of the local people, says Dr. Radhakrishna. Relief operations that were hampered by rains overnight eased a bit by morning. Local efforts in each area with massive support by the local people and the administration, along with the locally elected representatives and locally based volunteers, were central to organization of relief on that day. Helicopter reconnaissance by the Indian Navy helped the administration to identify various places where death and destruction had occurred along the coastline, while airdropping of food to those who were cut off at the Akare Pettai Panchayat gave some relief to the devastated village. It was becoming clear while Nagapattinam town was the worst affected, with Akare Pettai, Keechan Kuppam and Thirir Kuppam remained cut off from the outside world except by boats. Nagore, Velangani, Seruthur, Tarangambadi, Pumpuhar and each of the 73 hamlets along the coast had each their own stories to tell about woes that unfolded on the 26th morning. Continues Dr. Radhakrishnan, in all modesty, sharing all his achievements with the people whom the officer serves. During this period, what stood out was the constant resolve shown by the people to learn from nature's lessons and the resilience of the people and the government to develop communities which are not only resilient but also which strive for a safer world. These are pictures of the temporary shelters. Simultaneously, the focus has been not only restoring what was lost, but also aiming to change lives for the better as the rehabilitation process moved forward, Dr. Radhakrishnan adds. After Uttarakhand flash floods, disaster of June 2013, I interviewed General Anil Chheth, General Officer Commanding in Chief, Central Command, who led the search and rescue team. I asked General Chheth, describe the morale of the search and rescue team. The reply I got left me speechless, and I almost retired hurt. This is what he said in a written email interview. Now that's Tilly Smith, it's just going completely asynchronous. Please ask this question to those who were rescued or attended to. My experience centered around dealing with a situation for which there were no answers. That was your army and military in service of people to save lives of their countrymen whom they are sworn to defend. The morale has to be high when the cause is just and involves saving human lives. We had to adapt and improvise in this life and death situation. Situations were complex, ambiguous, uncertain and amorphous with no clarity of information. Challenges to leadership are very demanding during such periods. The important task of trudging every trail and combing the entire area of responsibility, find survivors, lift and assist our countrymen and shift them to relief centers from deep valleys, gorges and inaccessible areas without any surface communications, by creating innovative crossings over gushing rivers and nalas, negotiating steep gradients of mountains to take them safely to relief centers for further evacuation by helicopters were the challenges that cannot be explained in words. Photo essays could cover this more vividly and exhaustively. There were a number of impediments in this task. There was no definitive count of how many victims they would be required to save. The state in which these victims were, having already faced ravage for several hours, the requirements of medical assistance that would be needed, in some cases urgently, especially if a life was close to death or danger, and more significantly, to trudge every trail across a vast area on foot to locate such victims who in desperation had simply fled through any available route. After an overwhelmingly large number of victims were people from the plains, who were unaccustomed to the physical stress of sustained walking or climbing in the mountains. The other daunting factor was the inclement weather itself that continued throughout the operations in long or short spells, disrupting the effort. Such had been the complexity and the enormity of this task. While this was going on, the military, on the other hand, was also being required to provide doctors to attend to two ladies in Darachula sector who gave birth. As we accomplished this task, each and every other incident and moment of saving yet another person was a saga of immense determination, diligence and satisfaction for the soldiers. I salute my soldiers to have done this task in a most exemplary manner to the satisfaction of our countrymen. Soldiers of Gods was how our army was referred to by survivors in Uttarakhand. There cannot be a bigger reward than this. It is our bounden duty and honor to serve the nation to the best of our ability. I only pray to the God that we never fail. That was his, Dr. General Anil Chheth's words, Abdul Kalam. Although the tsunami was an unprecedented disaster which spread havoc in the Andaman Islands, the survival of teenager Meghana Shekhar was a story of utmost resolve and courage. Daughter of squadron leader P.V. Rajshekhar and Mrs. Sridhari Rajshekhar, she was swept away from the Air Force Station in Kanikobar by the tsunami waves along with her parents and younger brother. She kept clinging to a floating door for 2 days until the waves took her ashore. Her survival stands as a testimony to the indomitable human spirit and is a miracle in the midst of a disaster. Tragically, she lost both her parents and her brother in the catastrophe. The survival of Meghana induced a new spirit in the helicopter pilots and other search and rescue personnel in mounting renewed search for more such survivors over the next few days. 38 persons were rescued by air or sea from isolated locations in southern Nicobar Islands. Though agonized by the irreparable loss of her parents and brother, Meghana Shekhar migrated to Hyderabad to live with her grandparents. She visited Karnik on the first anniversary of the tsunami on the 26th of December 2005 and was the first kin to pay homage to the memorial in Karnik. This chapter is by no means an exhaustive and complete list of the tsunami heroes. And that is all for tonight. With that, we have completed chapter 10. In our next week's video, we will continue with I think it will be traditional wisdom of indigenous people and how did it help in emergencies. Please do subscribe to our channel and support us with encouragement to start a web series on disaster risk reduction. Please don't forget to tune in to the live interaction around 7:30 p.m. This week it is going to be on 6th of August, Friday, at 7:30 p.m. because I have a social commitment for Saturday. Next chapter, like I said, it will be about traditional wisdom of indigenous people in disaster mitigation. Does it help? Where and how? I hope to catch you up during the live interaction. Until then, take care, keep smiling, stay home, stay safe. Ciao.